Thank you very much for coming tonight. I wanted to talk to you a little bit about gas drilling and its similarities to coal mining. I live literally half a block up the street here, and I'm going to tell you through the presentation how I got involved, but I think that coal mining is a good way to get people to see the similarities of the gas drilling, and not just the drilling itself, but the infrastructure that's coming along with it that might affect us or our neighbors. I'd like to first give gas drilling a plug. From this National Geographic, we do have a lot of gas use in our country. The gas industry does provide jobs, and it does provide economic stimulus for some people and some communities. The gas drilling or fracking debate. Now, when I say a debate, normally a debate is done before an election. We've been fracking for 6-7 years in Pennsylvania. We're just debating it now. But the debate is one part science, one part politics, one part social, which is what this is today. We're here to talk, we're here to learn, we're here to ask questions. And I think that the last part is psychology of human nature and how we perceive things, how we perceive advertising. Now, that's not Billy Ray Cyrus. That's me with a mullet back in the early 90s. I'm in Pinedale, Wyoming to visit my brother who lived out there. You see the Grand Teton Mountains in the background? Fishing and hunting paradise. When I went out to visit him, I thought it was one of the most beautiful places I'd ever seen in the country. And I always thought that if I could, I would move there and retire someday. And that's my brother, and that's the bustling mall, the Pinedale behind him there. We're gonna fast forward to the year 2010. Here I am working, down here doing some video work for the local GOP party when they had their office on Public Square. I was eager to learn about these business opportunities that I heard about from the natural gas industry leasing land in the Back Mountain. And at the time, I was a Republican. So I came into this somewhat neutral when I heard about the lease and the gas, because I produce videos, corporate and industrial videos. Then I was flipping through the channels one night about 3 years ago, and I saw a story, I think it was on CBS, about how gas drilling came to Pinedale, Wyoming, and completely changed the face of the town. This is Sublette County, which is where Pinedale is. They have a county system similar to what we have. Pinedale sits right up here to the north. These are the Teton Mountains that you saw in the earlier picture. This is 1994. Gas drilling came in about 2001, 2002. That's 2003. All those little square spots that you see are gas drilling rigs. They are impoundment ponds where they keep water for fracking and for disposal. 2006. This is 2009, and these are not the kind of wells that we have here where they're drilling horizontally. These are just vertical wells. And that's, you go out a little bit further, and that's what the landscape looks like in Pinedale, Wyoming, in the mountain range. Now, these are mountains. Not a lot of people live there. It's very barren. It's beautiful, and there's a lot of animals that live there, but it's not very habitable to humans. One of the things that happened in Pinedale once the gas industry came in, they have more smog alert days than Los Angeles, California. Wyoming is the least populated state in the continental United States. They have increased crime. A lot of the jobs, the people that had in the community before gas, they went to work for the gas industry because they were paying more. So there are fewer restaurant workers, fewer police, and fewer local jobs. The local housing costs tripled because the renters from the properties can get a higher buck for them with all these people coming in from out of town working. Loss of community, that small town that they had and they loved, isn't around anymore. Heavy industrialization and wildlife migration issues. A lot of times in the West, you have herds of different types of animals roaming to find their food. They graze, they go to one area, eat it up, they go to another area. When you have all these pathways being disturbed, those migration patterns change, and they've been set for thousands of years. This is 30 miles from here. This is up in Springville. It's right past Tunkhannock. This is a four square mile section, and you can see the same type of patterns that you saw in Pinedale. There are about 21 gas facilities in this 4 mile square area. Now, the difference between Pinedale and Springville, Pinedale was in a mountain range. This is where people live, and this is where they farm. This is where we get our milk, we get our dairy, and we get our proteins and vegetables. 3 years of researching this has showed me that the same type of issues that happened in Pinedale are happening here. Decreased property values, health issues from compressors, deforestation of lands, excessive traffic and road damage, excessive noise, air and water pollution, lower quality of life, loss of tourism revenue, cleanup costs, and industrialized farmlands and residential areas. Just last week, this was the headline in the Citizen's Voice. Gas drilling has damaged 161 water supplies statewide. You would think that if you wanted to find out how much contamination was happening with gas drilling, you can call up the DEP and say, how many wells have been contaminated by gas drilling? Up until last week, they couldn't tell you because they haven't been tracking it. You would think that the Department of Environmental Protection, that would be their main goal, is to find out how much contamination is happening in our state. But it took a newspaper reporter to file a lawsuit to get the information. And this is what it says. Oil and gas development damaged the water supplies for at least 161 Pennsylvania homes, farms, churches, and businesses. Down at the bottom, 17% of the records found oil and gas activity disrupted water supplies, either temporarily or seriously enough to require companies to replace the spoiled source. Now, when they say disrupted water supplies, they're not talking about individual wells. Up in Dimmock, Pennsylvania, it was determined that there were 18 wells were affected by Cabot Gas and Oil back in 2010. Those 18 count as one of the 161 incidents up there. 90 of those are from methane migration, meaning that something that happened with the wells caused methane to go into people's water supplies. The other ones were chemical spills and things like that. What is fracking? A lot of you, I recognize some of you, and I know a lot of you know what it is, but there are a few people that might not know exactly what the process is. This little clip from a video from Chesapeake Energy will make it very simple for you to understand.
Once the lease agreement is signed, we prepare the drill site. Hurrah! Unless we encounter really bad weather. Chesapeake takes great care in preparing a safe, secure drill site. We look for locations to drill that will minimize disruption to the environment and urban areas. Reducing our environmental impact includes using a small area for the site, building roads while respecting the location, and using multi-well pad sites to drill several wells from a single spot. This helps us leave the smallest environmental footprint possible. Once the pad and necessary equipment are in place, we drill. That's your cue. Hurrah! Conventional, or vertical drilling, involves drilling straight down into a potential productive zone. unconventional drilling, diagonal or horizontal drilling, taps into areas that cannot be reached by conventional methods. See, this is conventional, moving straight down, and then presto, we go another direction. That's unconventional. These drilling techniques allow us to expose more of the gas formation to the wellbore, or the inside of the drilled hole, which is a key to success in many of the plays where we produce. It also allows us to place wells at a distance from homes, schools, and businesses, which people who live nearby appreciate. We use cement casings to prevent contamination of groundwater, as well as to strengthen the borehole. We often drill miles beneath the surface when we're searching for natural gas. Much of the natural gas reserves in the U.S. are found in a hard, non-porous rock called shale. It requires special techniques to extract natural gas, such as fracture stimulation. Okay, stop that. Fracture stimulation, or fracking, involves fluids pumped at high pressure into shale to fracture it. Sand is pumped into those tiny cracks to keep them open so natural gas can escape into the wellbore. It is our goal to recycle all fluids that return to the surface through normal production operations or dispose of them appropriately according to state regulations. From the wellbore, gas enters the gathering and compression systems of Chesapeake Midstream. This group of wholly owned subsidiaries provide a vital function preparing and moving the gas from the wellbore to market. As gas moves through the midstream process, liquids and impurities are removed. After the gas is cleaned and processed, it is then pressurized, so it can travel over long distances through a series of pipelines as it's transported to market. And now we can talk about royalty payments. After initial production begins in a well, mineral rights owners can expect to receive monthly royalty payments in about 90 days. And the payments can last for the life of the well, sometimes 30 to 50 years. When the first check arrives, the royalty owner's smile can be seen from orbit.
I would have loved to have been in the boardroom where somebody said, let's make a cartoon about fracking. Make it all warm and fuzzy. Apparently they have God on their side too, from the royalty payment angels. There's very technical videos. There's videos out there like this to make it simple for people. I think Range Resources had a cartoon dinosaur called Terry the Frackosaurus. To teach kids about fracking, the wonderful benefits about fracking. But there's all different, it's marketing is what it is. Here is a more realistic look at fracking. You have a well that goes down here. They drill approximately a mile down and a mile across. There are steel casings and cement that they put down to protect the aquifers. It takes about 5 million gallons, in Pennsylvania, approximately 5 million gallons of fresh water to frack one well. Frack fluid is composed of 88% water, 11% silica sand, and 1% chemicals. 1% chemicals doesn't sound like all that much, but 1% of 5 million gallons is 50,000 gallons of chemicals, some harmful, some benign. In Pennsylvania, they have drilling sites have anywhere from 1 to 20 wells per pad. Now, 20 is a lot. Sometimes the normal is probably about 10 wells per pad. So there can be up to a million gallons of chemicals that they use to frack. And if you think about the water usage, 5 million gallons of water times 20, that's a lot of water in fracking fluid. 20 to 80% of that chemical mixture stays in the ground forever. They pump it down, only 20% to 80% comes back up. The rest they leave. They plug the wells when they're done and that stuff's gonna sit there in the ground. 6.2 to 7.2% of Pennsylvania wells fail per year. That means that the casings crack, disintegrate. In that newspaper clip that you saw before, the 161 incidents of water contamination, that was caused by these well failures. And this particular number comes from Schlumberger, which is a gas company up in Canada. 60% of the wells fail over 50 years. All are going to fail eventually. So when these wells fail, you can have a couple of things happen. Fracking fluid may come up. Now, there's no cases in the United States yet of the fracking fluid coming up, but what is happening is that these casings fail. There's pockets of methane throughout. There's a lot of heavy metals that have settled over thousands, millions of years in the water aquifers. They get stirred up and they end up going into people's water supplies. 4 years ago, when I first started to get involved with this is one thing I found from one of the reporters gave me this map. Now, 4 years ago in Canada, a Canadian company leased over 2,000 parcels of land in Luzerne County for gas drilling up in the Lehman and Dallas area. Two of these properties, right here and right here, border on the Huntsville Dam, and that's where we get our water supplies. And they wanted, this is a typical gas pad. There's 10 wells on this particular pad. These are all trucks, almost trailer truck size trucks full of water for a frack operation. These are pumps. They wanted to put one of these here, 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 and here. I saw that and I thought, that's just absolutely crazy. This is our water supply. All of these dots, this is, here we are right here in Plymouth. We're down in this area down here. This pink line is called the Transco pipeline. It's a big pipeline that goes through Dallas, takes gas to the markets, Louisiana and down south. This is the Tennessee pipeline up through Bradford, Susquehanna counties. These dots, all these little red dots represent a permitted gas well. That's how many gas wells there are in Susquehanna, Wyoming, Bradford County. Each dot is connected to a gathering line. Each well is connected to a gathering line, which is a pipeline that takes it to a bigger pipeline that ends up taking it down to the Transco pipeline here. Right now, we have two pipelines that came in recently that meet right by the Dallas High Schools, and I'm sure you probably all heard about the Dallas High School compressor station that people fought and was able to get somewhere else. They were able to put it somewhere else. People have been saying that the Transco pipeline's been sitting there for 60 years with no problems. Well, these two new pipelines which they put in are a little over a year old. Each one of them had a major, major problem. Up here, an explosion at a compressor station evacuated people. That's in Springville. That's that little four square mile piece of land that I showed you earlier. And this particular one right here, which is in Beaumont, gas discharge noise startles neighbors again. That headline doesn't sound bad, but wait till you see the video I have on that. This is a news clip.
Do parents say they simply cannot believe that any type of industrial facility could be placed near schools or homes? They're urging people to turn out in mass to oppose that project.
These parents say they'll do whatever it takes to stop plans to place a natural gas compressor station near the Dallas Area School District complex.
Does everybody remember that? It happened about 2 years ago? Well, it had to go somewhere. And where did it go? Well, they put a part of it, they put a part of it called the glycol dehydration station up the road a couple of miles in Beaumont. A gas compressor station is a big unit that does a couple of things. Well, they took a part of it and put it up the road a bit, a couple miles. And this particular video shows you some of the problems that those people.
I'm Scott Cannon from the Gas Drilling Awareness Coalition. This video is about the residents living by a glycol dehydration station 15 miles west of Scranton, Pennsylvania. This station was built to remove water from the gas lines coming from the fracking operations in the northern counties. Folks here didn't know much about the gas up north, but some signed leases for a pipeline on their property so the gas could flow through this station into the Transco pipeline to be distributed to the rest of the country. the millions of dollars the gas industry spends on ads did what it was supposed to do, and the lessors fell for it. Of course, they weren't told about the negative effects.
Said if I remember the one zoning meeting that it was going to be put through no matter what.
But this hearing may be a bit futile. Act 13, which was passed by the legislature, supersedes most zoning with respect to oil and gas, and in this case, it makes what Chief has applied for a principal permitted use in an agricultural district.
The first red flag went up at the zoning hearing when a representative from the company building the station told a concerned mother with asthmatic kids that the only emissions coming out of the proposed plant would be methane.
I had asked about a variety of different things, methane, benzene, the toluene or formaldehyde. None of those will be there, or?
Well, of course, methane will be there. But the gas doesn't contain benzene.
Okay, no benzene, toluene?
Shouldn't have any in it.
Formaldehyde?
No formaldehyde either.
A file review of the permit showed something else. Wilma Subra, a nationally renowned chemist and consultant, explains.
So this is a general permit, which is a minor permit, which now doesn't require a public notice or a public comment period. So you see the same type of chemicals we've been talking about, the volatile organics, and this is pounds per hour and tons per year, 1.48 tons. Nitrous oxide, which is a precursor to ozone, you see over 11 tons a year. Carbon monoxide, formaldehyde, a known human cancer causing agent. Total hazardous air pollutants, and particulate matter. And we saw lots of particulate matter today.
We were told that it would have two holding tanks above ground, one building, and a light. Everything else would be underground and invisible, and that's exactly not what's there.
There was to be no motor. It was a small facility, and there was going to be no motor at all. But they absolutely said there would be no motor. Like, there's a lot of buildings, and I don't think anybody around here really realized how big it was going to be.
My understanding is one of these was supposed to go up in West Wyoming, and it was denied because it's zoned A1 agricultural, which is what we are zoned here, so why was it permitted here?
At the end of September 2012, just less than a week after the station went online, an accident occurred.
It was probably about 11 o'clock in the morning on a Sunday, and we heard this really loud noise, and we looked out, and it was the stacks down there from the dehydration plant.
I opened the door, and there I hit me right smack in my face. And here it was, that their dehydrating plant up there just spewing out gas all over the place.
And we looked out and the horses were gone. They blew through that gate, the fence. They had the corner of the fence was all broke down. The gate was bent into like a U-shape. It was just a really loud, sound like fighter jets pretty much, just hovering over the house.
Well, we had one horse out here in the back, and when that blew off down there, the horse got scared and ran through this gate. And it fell down and broke the PVC fencing and busted that post and broke that post. The sheep that are across the road, they were just bouncing off the wire. I felt so bad for them, but you can't do anything until, you know, the noise stops.
They told us that after the first time, they told us it would never go off again.
A month later, a louder, longer accident occurred.
Well, I was in bed, sleeping. It was before 3 o'clock in the morning. And all of a sudden, I heard this roaring. I thought my house was ready to blow up.
And this was taken inside my house the morning of November 24th. I woke up at 2:54 a.m., and it went till 3:35 a.m.
It sounded like 10 747 jets ready to take off. I mean, the noise was deafening.
Second time, It was like a jet engine running for almost a half an hour or so. It was extremely loud. You couldn't hear yourself think. And I walked out the front door there. It was like 3 a.m. I walked down the road, just a little, not a few hundred yards, and I could see the gas shooting about 50 or 100 feet in the air. Conkle Fire Department, they were all on the road, but they all stayed in the truck. I guess they weren't allowed to go down there. But it was like being on an aircraft carrier. That's what it sounded like.
The noise on it was unbearable. It just hurt my ears. It was so high-pitched, and it was downright scary. I'm a Vietnam vet. I've been in the war zone. I was in Marine Corps, and that there was downright scary.
The first time, like I said, the horses, we chased them about a quarter mile down the road before we finally got them, and they were all spooky. They were spooky for probably 2 weeks after that. The second time, they ran over and they hovered over into the corner. They knocked the fence down, but they must have got tangled in it and come back in. But they all hovered over in the corner next to one another.
There was a visible odor, and of course you could see the liquid shooting up in the air. My neighbor has said his whole home was engulfed by the smell.
My house was filled with, I don't know what it was, but my eyes was burning and my nose was running. I was gonna open up the doors and the windows to get whatever was out, but I figured whatever was outside, it was more outside than it was inside, so I kept everything closed. There was a big cloud that came down after they shut it down over the plant, like a big fog. It was all over the plant.
No one has informed us any danger that we're in or anything like that. And it was awful. It was an awful, awful experience. And then when it shut off, then try to go to bed, try to go back to sleep was forget it.
Other problems are starting to surface.
Well, if you put your arm against this door like this, you'll feel it like a pulsation or a vibration that we never had before. Ever since the station had been up, but I was alarmed when it first happened. I thought I was going nuts, but here it's actually the door vibrating or pulsating.
And that's the station right out the window?
Yes, it is.
Besides being an eyesore and ruining a beautiful piece of property, there's a constant rumble that never goes away. It's like having an old furnace in an old house just rumble, 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 24 hours a day. It never stops. And when they have the gas leaks, the noise is unbelievable. You don't know if you should run and hide or hunker down and wait for the big explosion.
Because of the constant vibration that is emitted by this station, the pictures on my wall vibrate, they shift, so every day I'm straightening them out. The mirror in my bathroom rattles, whether sometimes when it's completely closed, sometimes if it's open just a little bit, there's a constant rattling.
Well, eventually, our plaster and drywall, that's all going to start to crack, and even in our home, the windows in our medicine cabinet rattle.
The neighbor up the road says her porch vibrates continuously. I mean, who wants to listen to that 24/7?
My house inside has a vibration to it, and plus I hear the roar of the whatever is roaring up there in my home.
In the past probably 2 or 3 weeks, my garage door does rattle from the vibration of the plant.
What about your septic and your water, your well and all that stuff? Is that affected by that too, by the vibrations?
I'm worried about the safety to my family. What are we breathing in continuously that we weren't told? Certainly if they would lie to us about what was going to be placed above ground, they would lie to us about the chemicals that are being used in the processing of this station.
I'm an 8-year cancer survivor, and the emissions that come out of that are carcinogens, and I don't want to get cancer again of any kind.
I have a problem with headaches. They've been twice as worse since that station has been put here. I've had to double up on my medication.
I was diagnosed 3 years ago from the Veterans Administration Hospital. I have a lung disease, and I don't know if this is going to affect my lungs any more than what it is.
So what is the problem to me? What is the constant vibration? What is the smell? What's being released into the air that's affecting my health?
And then there's property values.
Well, it's probably depreciated by now. I mean, who'd want to buy a property here, with that time bomb there?
I have grandchildren I was going to will it to them when I passed on, but I don't know if they're even going to want it. And then try to sell it. I don't know what we can get for it.
I'm concerned about my property value. I wouldn't buy a place that was down the street from that, and I doubt that I'll be able to sell my home should I want to sell it. I'm paying full taxes on my property, whose now I'm sure has gone down in value. I don't trust the safety of the thing. I don't think it should be in an area where people live in residence.
Like I said, my wife and I, we put a lot of money and a lot of time in this place. And what we're going to get out of it, you know, I don't know. If we go to sell it, you know.
Who's going to come here and look at my home and see that conglomeration right up the road and say, oh yeah, I want to buy that house?
In December 2012, a meeting was arranged between state and local officials and PVR partners, the facility's owners, to discuss the lack of a safety plan. PVR partners didn't show up, but the community leaders got a schooling on why you shouldn't build an industrial park in a neighborhood.
You don't know what that thing's going to do, what it's capable of doing, or nothing. I mean, we saw the fire trucks up there and everything, but and then I said to my husband, I said, how can he even give any direction to his men? You can't hear anything at all. And even someone mentioned to me that they were going to get together and have a like a siren. Well, that's ludicrous because nobody's going to hear the siren. It's just, you can't hear anything over that.
I don't like the way the emergency response is set up. Nobody seemed to know what to do the other night when we had that big blow up here. We were told not, they couldn't go near it, so what good is the fire company? They come and they stand down. They were all the way down the street here by us. So what's going to happen if the thing ignites? Who's going to protect my property? Who's going to protect the lives of my family? Nobody.
If there were something that Senator Baker or Representative Bobeck can do, what would that be?
Well, I would prefer the thing would be removed from here, but I think that the gas company should just buy us out. If that thing is here to stay, then buy me out.
I like the plant to shut it down. I mean, I don't think it should be here as close as all these people or that we live right on top of this thing. This is a powder keg.
Oh boy, if they could shut it down, that would be super. But I think that I don't even know if we really want to live here.
These lower our property, our property taxes should be lowered, you know. I mean, some kind of, you know, restitution, I guess, you know. But buy us out, I don't know. You know?
I'd like to see the plant shut down now. They lied to us. It wasn't supposed to be this loud. I mean, we didn't have a clue what was going on. And I got a 17-month-old baby that's up around these horses. If my wife or my grandson's around them and that goes off, that's going to be a problem. And I had talked to them about it, but they were only worried about the gas they lost. That's all they were worried about.
I didn't move into the country to be looking at an industrial revolution right up the road from me. This is not supposed to be an industrial place. I could not move into an industrial zone as a residential person, so why should an industrial place be able to move into where people live? I mean, this is my home.
That's one of 11 videos that I've made on the gas drilling. It's called the Marcellus Shale Reality Tour, and they're all available on YouTube if you want to take a look at them. But that's literally 10 miles as a crow flies from where we're at right now. So all the gas drilling that you hear about up in different parts of the state, it's not just the gas drilling, it's the infrastructure that's going to be affecting us over the next 20 years. They say we're 10% into the gas boom. We have three pipelines moving into the area, so how many more pipelines are we going to get? How many stories like this are we going to get? We don't know. What has happened since this video? 13 families have filed a lawsuit against PVR Partners, the company that they didn't build the station, they bought it from a company called Chief. They hired a lawyer to file a lawsuit, and that announcement should be made very shortly. The first thing the lawyer did was recommend to reappraise their property values and to file with the county to have their property values lowered so they pay less taxes on the houses because they're not as valuable as they were. At that that safety meeting that you saw towards the end of the video, somebody had raised their hand and said, well, I'm starting to get nosebleeds. And then somebody else raised their hand and said, I am too, and about six hands went up. People are getting nosebleeds and headaches and sinus infections that they didn't have before. After 6 months, still no safety plan from PVR Partners. They were supposed to have a safety plan in place before the station went online. 6 months after, and all these problems, I talked to a resident yesterday, they still don't have a safety plan. How could something like this happen? In 2011, Governor Corbett created Act 13, and it was passed by a Republican General Assembly by a very narrow margin in February 2012. Act 13 strips away all local zoning laws pertaining to natural gas facilities, permitting these heavy industrial facilities to be built in an agriculture and residential area. The meeting that you saw in the beginning, the zoning hearing, the act had not been in place yet. It was going to be in place in the next month, but they voted yes to put it in anyway, thinking that Act 13 was going to go into effect. Well, what happened was the Democrats actually filed a lawsuit against it. So you see on the bottom here, Act 13 is currently being challenged in court. They could have said no to it, it could not have been built. And those people wouldn't be putting up with what they put up with. But they thought the law was going to go into effect, so they passed it. It also imposes a physician gag rule that would prevent doctors who are treating gas workers from disclosing chemicals that they have been exposed to because of trade secrets. And we have one such doctor here tonight if you want to, during the question and answer period, ask some questions. But if a person comes in who comes from one of these drill rigs and is exposed to certain chemicals, the physician has to call the gas company, get the list of chemicals that he was exposed to, and sign a waiver saying he will not tell anyone else what those chemicals are because they're trade secrets for the gas industry. So they're putting those trade secrets against public health. And it issued, Act 13 issued an impact fee to go only to municipalities with gas wells. We're lucky here, I feel we're lucky here in Luzerne County. We really don't have the kind of gas that, in the quantity that they need to be worth drilling here. So we got a little bit of money for the couple of drills, a couple of wells that they drilled, but they found nothing. So we get like about $400,000, which is a couple of road projects. And we will never see any money from the state under this act to help our roads and the damage that's being caused by the gas industry in our county. To the section on the similarities that I've seen with coal mining and gas drilling, I grew up in this area. I'm from Wilkes-Barre originally. I've lived here in Plymouth for 10 years. I had an uncle who died in the early 70s of complications from black lung disease. I had a grandfather who tended the horses and the mules for the mines right up here in Plymouth. Now, he died in 1944 from pneumonia. But I started to see a lot of similarities between gas drilling and coal mining. Now here, an example of land scarring. Now, this is called mountaintop removal, where they literally take a big top of the mountain, cut it down, and extract the coal. This is a gas drilling rig, I believe, in West Virginia. And it's got a similar look to it. As far as the respiratory problems, the coal mining had coal dust, which caused black lung. The gas industry, as part of the sand that they use to do the drilling, is crystalline silica. And it's a carcinogen when it's dry and it gets into the air, and that causes silicosis, which is a respiratory problem. Explosions and accidents, you always hear...
It really looks looks like a disaster.
The victims of the country's latest natural gas explosion in Allentown, Pennsylvania, include an infant and a couple in their 70s. A block of row homes was destroyed. Last month, the natural gas explosion in Philadelphia sent a fireball 50 feet into the air, killing a utility worker. Last September, a blast in San Bruno, California, killed 8, destroying 38 homes, part of a disturbing trend. But in the last 6 years, pipeline accidents have killed more than 60 and injured more than 240 people. There are more than 400 inspectors nationwide, but the National Pipeline Safety Act, which regulates how they do their job and compels gas companies to report problems such as leaks, lapsed last October and hasn't been addressed since.
When I think about the people killed today, and one of whom was a baby, the answer is clearly no. They're not as safe as they could or should be.
Just looking at what's happened in the last several months makes that point tragically clear.
This is a woman named Sherry Barks, and she's a friend of mine, and she's featured in that same National Geographic magazine from December of last year. And she lives in Granville Summit, Bradford County, and this particular video went viral. It's got about 1 million views to it. It's a shot of a woman lighting her tap on fire. You've probably seen that on the news. I get Sherry to explain exactly what happened. Chesapeake Gas, the company that fracked her her land in her backyard, saw the video. They do not dispute this at all. And it's pretty powerful.
I can often hold a standard kitchen match to my water, and like I said, it is unpredictable, but the methane randomly travels with the water, and sometimes it will light quite spectacularly. Just like that.
Now, Chesapeake is going to say, well, there's natural occurring methane in the wells already. What do you have? What's your reply to a comment like that?
My reply is that their post-fracking test, their own, the methane tested 0.01 milligrams per liter. And since July of 2010, it has tested as high as 64 milligrams. So obviously something has changed.
And usually you can method, they say as long as it aerates, it's safe to drink. And usually you can see a little bit of gas just aerating out of there. Not really, you can see it or not. Sometimes you have to hold it this way.
Yep. One of the issues that they've been having with coal mining is mine subsidence, where the earth basically collapses in through abandoned mines. And with the gas drilling, we're having issues with...
In Arkansas, some geologists think the disposal of wastewater from fracking may be leading to an incredible uptake in earthquakes, more than 1,100 since September.
At this Arkansas school, anger is in the air.
You need to start hounding your government.
The residents gathered here are worried.
How would we know?
About the gas wells sprouting up around them.
I just know my house started shaking.
And whether drilling is to blame for the earth literally moving under their feet.
There's about 1,050 earthquakes.
Arkansas geologist Scott Osbrooks is a lead detective on the case.
And so these dots represent
earthquakes.
More than 1,000 earthquakes
that have occurred
just since last summer.
Yes, sir. Just since basically since September.
The earthquakes are rattling the countryside in what's known as the Fayetteville Shale. Just since 2005, more than 3,000 gas wells have been drilled here, bringing thousands of jobs and billions in revenue to a dirt poor place. but at what cost?
Another problem is acid mine drainage from the mines. And if you've ever driven by Solomon's Creek in Hanover Township, you see that it's a very orange creek. I drive by it almost on a regular basis. But here's why. If you ever wondered why Solomon's Creek in Wilkes-Barre and Hanover is orange, this is the source of it right here. It's a mine sinkhole that's pouring up acid mine drainage. This is the clean part of the creek. It comes down here. It intersects with that section. And then it's pretty much dead from here on out. And then blowouts and methane migration, you see those in the news. I think you've seen two or three of them in the last 2 months up in up by the Procter & Gamble plant. There's an area up there that seems to be having
a day of cleaning up at this gas drilling site in the northern tier. Now people who live near here can only wonder about possible long-term effects of today's leak.
Chesapeake Energy officials say thousands and thousands of gallons of drilling fluid have leaked in this quiet community near Canton from the company's well pad.
It becomes very briny after it's exposed to the shale, and that's what we're trying to contain on location, and that's what's in the well right now.
Most we spoke with say they're worried about what the leak means for their water supplies, and in this farming community, that means water for them and their animals.
Another issue are abandoned boreholes, abandoned gas wells. They look very similar. They've been saying that we've been fracking for 60 years in Pennsylvania with no problems. We have a lot of problems, and I'll show you that later. But this is an abandoned gas well sitting on somebody's piece of land that's, I don't know how old it is, but basically there's water and brine coming up, polluting the land here. And this is a mine borehole coming off the side of a mountain. You can see the difference. It's iron. That's causing the orange coloration. Influence peddling, lobbying, we have it with coal mining, we have it with the gas drilling industry. The new state legislation retirement plan, get a consulting job with the gas industry after your now this is equal Democrat and Republican offenders here. They've done work and are currently, I know Ed Rendell is working with the Range Resources at the present time. Who's next? This guy. You know he's going to be getting a job with the gas industry when his time comes.
A lot of times things are right underneath our feet, and all we need to do is change the way we're thinking about them. A couple decades ago, we didn't even realize just how much natural gas was trapped in rocks thousands of feet below us. Technologies made it possible to safely unlock this clean and burning natural gas. These deposits can provide us with fuel for 100 years, providing energy security and economic growth all across this country. It just takes somebody having the idea, and that's where the discovery comes from.
Now, I make TV commercials, and you've probably seen a couple over this past election. I won't tell you which ones they are, but I'm in advertising, and that's a good example right there of a warm, fuzzy feeling TV commercial. Now, the gas industry actually hired the same advertising agency that made these ads in the 1950s to raise doubt in the public's mind about the dangers of fracking. Arthur Godfrey, some of you older folks might know who he is. Scientific evidence that smoking is safe for you back in the 1950s. This is a current ad. It says, now this Cabot's a gas drilling company that's has a lot of wells up in the Montrose Dimmock area. They say, we're committed to 100% recycling of our water. 100% of their water, they're committed to recycling. Well, some of the information I showed you before, if 20 to 80% of the water used in fracking stays in the ground, how can this be true? They're going to say they're committed to 100% water recycling, yet that percentage of water that they use to frack wells is going to stay in the ground forever. All the fracking waste water will never return to the aquifer. It contains radioactivity and chemicals that can't be filtered by modern technology as of yet to make it completely pure and drinkable. So it eventually, they'll use some of it, recycle a little bit of it for a next a drill, but then it all eventually ends up going into those disposal pits, which you saw earlier that caused earthquakes in Arkansas, Oklahoma, Ohio, and Texas. This is Sherry Markson again. She talks about what happened to her, and I thought this would be a good part of the presentation.
So you've got this compressor back there with an access road that's being used by the gas company almost a weekly basis?
Oh, daily.
Daily basis, and you didn't sign on for any of this?
Well, when we agreed to the access road being here, we were all given the impression that they were temporary. Again, this is a term I've learned that the gas company uses very vaguely. Temporary for me is not temporary for them. They're very friendly because they want something from you. They want your property. And they are willing to bend over backwards and answer what appears to be any of your questions. And I'm here today to tell you that for every question you think they answer, there's probably 10 of them they didn't. If you're not satisfied with the answer they give you, please ask somebody else, because I won't say the gas company will lie to you, but I'll tell you they withhold information, and they're not as upfront as they appear to be.
I'd love to send a copy of that to my representatives.
Sherry was told by the gas company that they were going to come in and drill, and in 3 months they would replant and have a little Christmas tree, which is some piping out of the ground. 3 years later, she's got an industrial park in her backyard still. And sometimes with armed guards to keep people like me away. I got a call from a Maryland public television station that was going to do a documentary on gas drilling, and they called me for my footage on this because they went down there to get their own, and Chesapeake Energy had armed guards that wouldn't let them in, even though Sherry Markson would allow it, Chesapeake would not. To wrap things up, don't believe the hype that you hear. You hear a lot of radio commercials, you hear a lot of TV advertising. They promise you the world, they deliver very little. Think and research for yourself. If you want to know about the harmful effects of smoking, do you ask a cigarette salesman? So when you're talking to somebody from the gas industry, realize that they're doing a job, and their job depends on gas and getting it to market. Pay attention to the stories that are in the media, because there's a lot of them. There's usually about 3 a week in our local papers. So take a look, read them. Get your information from real news sources. I might offend somebody, but Fox News is not a real news source. Take a ride up Route 29 and see it for yourself. Take your own reality tour. Go up and see it. See if you think that's something that you want. Now, the whole thing with this is, you can have this if you want it, but if you don't want it, you have to do something about it. And it's okay to not want this. What can we do to protect ourselves? Real quickly, strengthen local municipal zoning laws, strengthen county zoning laws. Some municipalities, like West Wyoming right now, they're going through a fight. They don't have their own local zoning laws, so they rely on the Luzerne County laws. You can strengthen state laws, tax the industry to pay for damage, use your voting power to elect environmentally aware candidates. You can have a moratorium, which means to hold off drilling until better technology and laws are in place, or you can strive for a ban, which is to stop drilling altogether and focus on renewable energy. What I think we should do, this is our state constitution, Article 1, Section 27, states the people have a right to clean air, pure water, and to the preservation of natural, scenic, historical, and aesthetic values of the environment. Pennsylvania's public natural resources are the common property of all the people, including generations yet to come. As a trustee of these resources, the Commonwealth shall conserve and maintain them for the benefit of all people. And if you're a Tea Partier, you're for states' rights. And that's right in our state constitution. So that would make you upset if you were a Tea Partier. This is what I think we should do. And this is my opinion. Impose a state moratorium on gas drilling until laws are in place to protect us better and technology catches up to be proven reliable, if possible. After all, the gas is not going anywhere. Right now, New York, the state of New York, is watching what's happening here. They have a moratorium on gas drilling. They're looking at us to see our mistakes and to see what we're doing. I think we should do the necessary long-term studies on health and environmental impacts of gas drilling before continuing to do it. Retool the DEP or start another agency that will protect our environment and health. Put an environmental scientist in charge, not a gas industry lawyer like Prancer, Governor Corbett's pick and former DEP head who just resigned. He went back to his law firm and is promoting natural gas. So we don't know who the next DEP head is going to be, if there's even going to be one from his administration. Define acceptable loss for gas drilling. In other words, how much environmental and health damage is acceptable before it stops? Nobody has defined how much damage is too much damage. And that should be defined before we let it happen. Put an end to the term safe and responsible gas drilling. You hear that, and you're gonna hear it in every political commercial coming up this next year. No one has actually defined what safe and responsible gas drilling is. It does not exist. So get rid of it until we determine what the acceptable loss for safe and responsible gas drilling really is. Start taking government subsidies away from the gas and oil industries and put them towards renewable energy development and implementation, especially solar energy, to make it affordable. And that's the key. Our government needs to make it affordable. And finally, get involved. If you do nothing or wait for somebody else to do something, you will get no change. It's my belief that the gas drilling will cost us more in the long term than we can afford. I have some documentation up here on some of the points that I, thank you. I know this is a real bummer on a real hot day, but these are the things we really need to know in order to make informed decisions to move forward. We see the ads and we see how great it is and how many jobs it's going to bring, but we rarely see this side of the story, and this is an equal side of the story as well. So we need to see both to be able to make an informed decision.